comes to fight for me. I'm gonna sing in the middle of the storm, louder and louder. You're gonna hear my praises roar up from the ashes. Hope will arise. Death is defeated. The King is alive.
I raise a hallelujah. The darkness flee. I'll raise a hallelujah in the middle of a mystery. I'll raise a hallelujah. Fear you lost your hold on me.
A table that you've prepared for me in the presence of my enemies. It's your body and blood you shed for me. This is how I fight my battles. There's a table that you prepared for me. In the presence of my enemies. It's your body and blood you shed for me.
Come.
your body and blood you shed for me. This is how I fight my battle.
We want to take some time this morning to remember Jesus, who helps us in our battles, as the song suggests. And so if you haven't gotten one of those cups from the side, our ushers will be handing them out, and you can raise your hand and they'll be they'll hand it off to you. But as they're doing that, I just want to explain a little bit about communion. This is what's called the Last Supper. This is what Jesus did before he was essentially sentenced to be crucified and tortured for us. Even though he didn't deserve it at all, he laid down his life for us. And so he sits down with his disciples, and they take part of the bread and drink the wine, as we're about to do, and except we have grape juice this morning. He takes that time. And Luke, if you read the passage from there, it says, "Do this in remembrance of me." You see, this was one of the last times that Jesus would get to be with them physically. One of the last times that he would get to be with them where he's evidently there, where they can see him clear as day. And there's times in our life where we can feel Jesus, where we can see him work miracles, where we can see him do healings, like he healed the blind, where he walked on water, just as the disciples did. We can see him move in our lives in a clear and evident way. But there's also times in our life where maybe we're caught up in that storm. Maybe we're caught up in that battle. And we can't see him as evidently as we normally would, as clearly as we normally would. And those are the times where maybe we just need to take a step back and just remember him. We don't do communion just because it's a tradition that we've done always. We do communion because it's in remembrance of all he's done for us. All he's done for us. So I want to read out of Matthew 26. And again, this is the institution of the Lord's Supper. This is one of his last meals with his disciples. He says, "And now as they were eating, Jesus took the bread and after blessing it, broke it and gave it to the disciples and said, 'Take, eat, this is my body.'" Can we all take the wafer this morning in remembrance of him? "And he took a cup, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, 'Drink of it, all of you. For this is my blood of the covenant, which is poured out for many for the forgiveness of sins. I tell you, I will not drink again of this fruit of the vine until that day when I drink it new with you in my Father's kingdom.'" And if we could all take a drink. Let's pray. Lord, thank you for what you've done. Thank you that even in the hard times, even in the times where we feel lost, where we don't feel like we can feel your presence, you're still there. You're still with us. You still love us. You still treasure us, regardless of what we've done, regardless of what we do. What you've done for us covers it all. And we thank you and praise you. And in Jesus' name, amen.
Walking around these walls, I thought by now they'd fall, but you have never failed me yet. Waiting for change to come, knowing the battle's won, but you have never failed me yet. Oh. promise still stands. Great is your faithfulness, faithfulness. I'm still in your hands. This is my confidence. You've never failed me yet. I know the night won't last. Your will come to pass. My heart will sing your praise again. Jesus, you're still still stands. Great is your faithfulness, faithfulness. I'm still in your hands. This is my confidence. You never fail. Your promise still stands. Great is your faithfulness, faithfulness. I'm still in your hands. This is my confidence. You never failed me.
Father God, that each one of us comes here this morning with burdens. God, we each come in carrying something this morning. And so, God, this morning, we lay them at your feet. And God, we ask that you take these burdens from us. God, your word says to cast your cares. And so, God, we do that this morning. God, and we thank you that we get to do that. God, we thank you for the relationship that we have with you through your Son. And so, God, I ask that no matter where we're at this morning, no matter where everybody is at this morning, God, that you will just help us to feel and know that you are walking with us in the midst of a storm. And that, God, your word never promised no storms, but your word promises that you will walk with us through them. And so, God, we stand on that promise this morning. God, we thank you for who you are. We thank you for the relationship that we have. And just ask, God, that you will help us to always be mindful of that and never lose sight of you in the middle of a storm. We ask all of this in your Son's name. Amen. Amen. All righty. Thank you so much. Good morning. Welcome to Grace Union Church. My name is Jason. I'm one of the pastors here, and we are excited that you are with us this morning on a supposed to be like mid-60s day, but also more importantly, the day that the Chiefs are going to win the Super Bowl. And so that's super exciting. So we can all remember back, hey, remember that day that we were all together when the Chiefs won? That is what today is. So we're excited that you are here with us today. So if you are new with us, or if it's the first time in a while, you come in, you check out a church, you want to know what we're about. So first thing you should know is that we're Chiefs fans. Second, get out. There's doors right there labeled with exit. We do have security. We are a church that is all about encountering grace right where you are and then being moved by that grace towards all that God has for you. So even if you're a 49ers fan, there is grace sufficient for you today. And then on your journey to becoming a Chiefs fan, there is grace each step of the way. No, we believe that God has a plan for your life, and that no matter what's happened to you, no matter what you've been through, that there is grace, and that God wants to do something in your life. And as that plan unfolds, we believe that there is grace each step of the way. So you'll hear us talk about our three P's. We pray together, we pursue together, and we party together. So grab your program on the way in. Hopefully you got one of those. All types of good information to know about there. So be sure to take a look at that. And then the other thing that I would invite you to grab is there's connection cards in the seat backs right in front of you. I would ask that everybody grab one of those, no matter if this is your first time at Grace Union or your 1,000th time at Grace Union, because we reformatted those. We want everybody to complete that. We want to make sure we've got your information updated. So even if you are a regular attender, I would invite you to go ahead and fill one of those out. And then if this is your first time or first time in a while, you can drop that in the offering bags here in a few minutes, or you can exchange it for a free gift out at the Connect Center. We'll just send you a message, just say hi, all that kind of stuff. We're just excited that you're here with us. So there are a few things on the connection card, a little bit different. So as I'm kind of reading through announcements, you might want to check some boxes. So be sure to look at that. All right, so the first thing I want to draw to your attention, the Who We Are lunch is next Sunday. So if you are newer to Grace Union, this is a great, great thing for you to sign up to be a part of. We will have a delicious lunch by Noodles and Company, and they provide the noodles and you provide the company. That joke was written for me, but no, see, it got kind of what I thought it would get. This is just a great time next next Sunday after service, we will have some lunch and just get to know you a little bit and let you know kind of who we are. We'll get to know a little bit about who you are, tell you a little bit about kind of the history of the church, who's who. It gets you just a good way to connect if you are newer to Grace Union and just want to learn more about how to get connected. So be sure to sign up. You can do that on the connection card. Just check that box, drop it in the offering bags. It will take place after next week after service in the youth area. So it's just kind of out these doors and then to the left around there. There'll be signs directing you. So we'd like to see you at that. 2 weeks from today, water baptism, Sunday, February 16th. If you have never been baptized by in water, or maybe you were as a kid and as life has kind of, you know, God has taken you on your journey and God has brought you here and you want to take that step, we want to give that opportunity for you. So if you've got any questions about that, if you've got any kind of thoughts or just kind of want to, hey, I want more information, or maybe you're like, hey, I am committed, I want to do that. It's just a great opportunity for you to take a step forward in what Jesus told us to do, but then also it gives you a great opportunity to invite friends and family and people to church, because they're going to come and they're going to applaud for you and all of that. So be sure to sign up for that, and then on the connection card. And then also our first ever growth track will be starting in less than a month. So this growth track, there's multiple kind of levels that are going with this. The first level that we want, and we want everybody to go through this, whether you are brand new to Grace Union or you're a member and have been here for years, we want everybody to go through this. The first level is only 5 weeks. It'll be 5 Wednesday night, 1-hour sessions. And it'll start here at the beginning of March. And this is going to cover everything from Bible basics and what it means to be a Christian, all the way to kind of what we, you know, what you feel like God is calling you to and what he's been doing in your life, and kind of what we believe here at Grace Union and the vision that we have and how you can become a member, how you can become a leader. It's going to cover all of that kind of stuff. So the, like I said, the first level is just 5 Wednesday nights, 1-hour sessions. It'll start in March. It is space limited. And so we've only got room for 40 people. So you sign up for that on the connection card. And so we want to get everybody through this year. So this is just the first 5-week session that we're offering. We will offer more throughout the year because we do want to get everybody through this. And so it's just a really cool, exciting time to kind of get to know more about, you know, what your Bible says, what we believe, who, you know, and you build relationships with those that you're in the class with. And so I would just encourage you to be a part of that and talk with Pastor Bob, talk with myself. We'll tell you more about what that is going to look like. But we want everybody connected to that. So if you can sign up for that on the connection card. And then the last thing, youth ministry monthly email updates. There is a sign up in the foyer after service. If you want to make sure to receive the monthly email updates from our youth ministry, just be sure to sign up right out front in the foyer. There will be an opportunity to do that. And with that, I'm going to invite Pastor Bob.
Well, I want to invite our ushers we're going to receive the tithes and offerings as they're coming, and you guys are busy filling out those connection cards. I know that, like, well, that's everybody but me. Go ahead and do it, because it's not everybody but you. It's everybody and you. But anyway, really quickly, I thought I'd touch on this. The growth track, the first ever growth track that we're going to kick off here in a few weeks, almost a month, is if you go through this one, you'll be the first people ever to get to use the new Ministry Hub room. And so that is actually why we've pushed back the start of the growth track, because the Ministry Hub room is obviously not finished yet. And so we're excited about the construction that's going on, the room that we're building. And so you will get to be the first people to get to use that space. And so there's no other promises other than you'll get to sit in the room, but you'll be the first people to sit in that room. And so so make sure you sign up for the growth track. Again, hey, if you're kind of newer here, I'd love to hang out with you at lunch next week. And so it's good food. It's Noodles & Company. I think we have chicken pad thai, just because I love that. So sign up for that. I'd love to hang out with you for that. And so cool. as you guys are still filling out, getting ready, I wanted to just take a second and say, here's why we give. We don't give to keep lights on. We don't give to heat the room or anything like that. We give because ultimately, as we invest in what God is doing in the church, people meet Jesus. And so next week or in two weeks, we'll see a bunch of people get baptized. And that's part of what we do as a church, is that we actually help. Some of these will be kids that are growing up in the church. They're learning their faith as they grow. Some will be adults who've met Jesus mid-journey through life. And so I want to encourage you, that's why we do what we do. And everything that we do comes back to that. Whether we're serving, we've got people right now serving our kids back there in our elementary space, serving our students. Whatever we do as a church, it all comes down to the fact that Jesus came to be the man that and the woman that we couldn't be. The Son of God took on human flesh to live the life that we were accountable to God to live but couldn't live. And then he died in our place, accepting the punishment for sin in our place. And he offers us this exchange of places freely. And that's ultimately the gospel, is that we put our faith in Jesus and our sin was then punished in him. And his righteous life is attributed to us. And that means that now we get to move forward in a life of blessing from God. That God blesses us now. We're not under a curse. God's not angry at us, because when he looks at us, he sees the righteousness of his Son, Jesus. And that's why we do everything that we do, is to help as many people understand that and live in the freedom of that as possible. And so as we give, that's what you're giving to. Let's pray. Father, we're so grateful for your love and for how it's played out in the gospel of Jesus. I ask that as we give, God, that you would renew that vision in our hearts and our lives, both of gratitude and thanksgiving to you for what the gospel means to us, but also of passion and excitement and compassion for the world around us for what the gospel could mean to them. And so I pray that you'd help us in everything we do to accomplish that mission. In Jesus' name, amen. All right, make sure you drop those connection cards in as they go by. They're going to hit. Whip, run me like a racehorse, pull me like a ripcord, break me down and build me up. I want to be the slip, word upon your lip, rather that you rip, break me down and build me up. Whatever it takes. On week 5 now of our series, Whatever It Takes, and really it kind of comes down to this. In 2020, we want to do whatever it takes. Jason mentioned earlier what our mission is, that you people would experience grace right where they are and then be moved by grace toward all that God has for them. And so really everything that we do as a church hangs on those two things, that people would encounter the gospel of Jesus and they would receive forgiveness and wholeness from God right where they are, but also that we would be able to join arms with people and help them as they journey forward. Because the truth is, God's plan is bigger than just forgiveness. God's plan is to give you a whole life. And some of you guys know Brian, who joined us in baptism a few weeks ago, right? Or a couple months ago. And man, how long is it, Brian? How many weeks clean, months? Are you 6 months clean now? What's that? 5.5 months clean after 30 years. 30 years, right? Doesn't remember a sober day in 30 years, and God's touched his life. And again, it's bigger than just forgiveness. Yeah, is he headed for heaven? Is he headed for new life in Jesus? Yeah, but man, God's transforming his life. He's transforming his marriage, work, and doing all kinds of incredible stuff. And so here's the thing. That's what Jesus does when he comes to town, right? That's when he shows up in your life. That's what he does. And so that's why we exist as a church. And here's what Whatever It Takes is about, why we're going through this series. Because over this next year, we say, you know what? We're not going to approach this casually in our own lives. Like, we're going to do whatever it takes for me to be a part of that happening in more people's lives and for me to grow into all that God has for my life. And so that's what this is all about. And so part of that, we talked last week, we're going to talk again this week, is about making the body of Christ, the church, making the body really the body. And I mentioned this in a prayer meeting with some of the team earlier this morning. You know, it's great to have good preaching, and someday I hope that you guys will have it. But it's great. It's great to have good preaching, and it's great to have great worship music, and it's great to have cool buildings and all that stuff. But if the church can figure out how to live and function as the church, we would never be able to build buildings big enough to contain it. If people could walk in here and experience Jesus's love poured out through our lives, we wouldn't have to do anything else, right? And so I really want to encourage you today as we jump into this, man, to not just hear this stuff, but to be, hear it and go, man, how do we live differently? And I almost forgot, I promised to make an announcement for Jerry and Scott. We mentioned the prayer team last week. You guys may have been here for that. You might not have been here. So we're starting a team of people who are praying for needs, praying for the church as a whole. And what's happening is that nobody ever wants to pray every day. And so they're recruiting a team large enough so that people only have to pray certain days. No, I'm just kidding. But basically, they'll visit people in hospitals. But even beyond that, maybe you don't have to sign up. It's not another job. Maybe you just want to stay at home and pray for people who have needs, maybe make contact with people and all that kind of stuff. And so if you have interest in that at all and you didn't get to meet with them last week, as soon as service ends, they're going to be in conference room A, which is like out and over. And so you just kind of just move this way and then move that way. And so you'll be able to find them. They can give you some instructions. They'll get contact info from you, and they'll tell you more about it. And so if that's something you're interested in, see them. I showed a picture. We're going to show it again this week. If you were not as cool as me growing up, and you did not watch this, I'm going to give you the lowdown. This is Voltron. He is the defender of the universe, all right, as opposed to He-Man, who's the master of the universe. But anyway, Voltron, defender of the universe, this was an incredible cartoon when I grew up. They made a new version of it. It's terrible. Only watch the old one. But Voltron, this was made up of five robot lions that were each piloted by these heroes, right? And so Voltron was the defender because there was this evil galactic space force that was trying to take over the galaxy, enslave all the people of the galaxy. And Voltron was created to defend against this evil space force. And so every episode of Voltron would center around some planet that's trying to be taken over by the evil galactic space force, okay? And so ultimately they would always create an enemy for each episode, and they called it a what? Who remembers? A Robeast, right? And these Robeasts were these robotic beasts. Someone, yeah, there you go, you got it. Robotic beasts. And they were giant, and they were menacing, and they would take over a planet, and then Voltron would hear about it, and the lions would come, and they would fight, and what would happen is the Robeast would be so powerful that he'd begin overpowering the lions, right? And it would cut to all these scenes, and they'd be going, and they'd be injured, and ultimately he would almost destroy Run of the Lions, usually the green one. For some reason, Pidge was the weakest, right? And so they would just almost destroy a lion, and then someone would have an idea. What was it? Let's form Voltron, right? And so the five lions would join together, and they would create this giant champion, Voltron. Voltron would take out his blazing sword, and he would cut the Robeast in four pieces. It would explode. The victory was a guarantee the moment they formed Voltron. And I told you last week that as I got older, I began to wonder, why did they ever not form Voltron? Right? Why was it ever an option to fight as the five individual lions? Right? Why didn't they just show up and automatically go, oh, it's a Robeast? You know, last time we won when we formed Voltron, right? And so really, it's kind of obvious the point that we're making. The real power was unleashed when they joined together. And as Christians, as individuals, we can do some pretty cool stuff. I know some of you guys, and God works in your life, and you do great stuff, right? And just in your individual life, you have a great impact on people that you know. And so as individuals, we can do some cool stuff. But what we want to talk about last week and this week is that the real power is unlocked when we form the body. When we gather together in unity, something powerful happens. We read this last week, but I'll read it again. Ephesians 3:10 and 11 says this. His, and His is God. His intent was that now through the church, the manifold wisdom of God should be made known to the rulers and authorities in the heavenly realms according to His eternal purposes that He accomplishes in Christ Jesus our Lord. Now, that word manifold wisdom, doesn't that sound cool? And some of you go, I have no idea what that means, manifold, right? I think a car has one, but manifold wisdom of God. That word manifold actually means great variety. So what this is saying is that through the church, the power of God is somehow multiplied into great variety. And it's kind of like, I have a picture of a prism here. Some of you guys have done this in school where you shine light at a glass prism, and what happens? It separates that light. It multiplies it into separate streams of individual color. And that's essentially what that verse is saying, is that when we join together, God's power then shines through the church, and when it hits us, it scatters into all these individual streams. And there's a stream going through you, and a stream going through me, and a stream going through someone else, but it only happens when we're joined together as one, and then we become these individual varied displays of His wisdom and His power, these unique streams. And each stream is a full expression of the whole, but it's unique as it's unleashed through each of us as individuals. And I want to start by making a kind of unusual point. But in the church, God intends for as much or more spiritual value to be exchanged from person to person as from platform to person. And we don't think about this very often because everything comes from up here, right? People with microphones on, people on the stage, and we think that's what I'm coming to the church for. I'm coming to receive what's said, what's sung, and what's done. And the flow is from up here to out there. But what we're focusing on today is that God's intention is that as much or more value should be flowing from person to person within the church. As each of us figure out who we are in Jesus, and as we begin to unite and connect to each other, you should walk out of here some days 10 times more encouraged by what someone next to you said to you throughout that morning than from what you heard from the platform. And that's totally acceptable. Yeah, that's God's plan, that He would actually use a John or a Jim or a Lisa, and He would actually speak through them with the same degree of power that He might speak through somebody from up on a stage. That's His plan for the church. That's how much He believes in each of us. So have you ever stopped to consider that God may have you here and have another person here at the same time so that you can be the conduit of His power and His love and maybe even of some instruction or encouragement to them? Have you stopped to consider that maybe the most important thing that many people may hear today may come from alongside them in the congregation? Which is why it's such a bummer, and it breaks my heart when I talk to people who say, man, you know what, I'm trying to get to know people at the church here, but people just kind of, as they walk by, they just kind of look down at their phones, and they don't know me, and they don't want to get to know me, right? Because we just want to do what's comfortable for us. We just want to stay in our own bubble. We know our six people, and we're glad to talk to them, but we see someone that we don't know, and there's not many people around, so then we kind of, if I walk over there, I'm going to have to talk. You know, it's like we got to get out of, we got to get past that and recognize that maybe you're here today because of that person. That maybe as you get to know them, you're going to find out, man, I actually like that person. And actually, God's going to use you. And you never know. There's so many times in life that years later, I run into people that I've known from the church and that I've just had 1,000 conversations with. And they say back to me something that I said to them like 15 years ago. And it's not something I said in a sermon. It's not something I even remember saying, right? I'm like, oh, it wasn't important to me. It didn't even register with me. But God knew what they needed. And as we're sharing, as we're talking, some encouragement on a personal level, is something that made all the difference in that person's life. And that's God's intention for each of us, that there would be ministry going this way as well as ministry going this way. And if you think about the numbers, how much more significant should what's going this way be? If there's just one person talking this way, five or six people singing songs this way, but there's 300 people with the capacity to do ministry going this way, how much more significant is your contribution, or could be your contribution? You see, here's the key though. When the church unites as the body, the potential for the power and the wisdom of God to be unleashed, it's multiplied. Like that verse said, the manifold wisdom of God. All of a sudden it can spring out into all these new possible avenues. And it's not just Sunday morning. Sunday mornings are great. We put a huge emphasis on that. But it's at Friday night house parties, right? When we have Friday, like if you missed it, Friday night, I had my clothes on backwards. It was crisscross. It was decades. It was awesome. We had a great time, right? Someone's like, I thought you'd wear them backwards again today. It's not like a month. It was just one party. But anyway, on Friday nights at house parties, Voltron forms. That's what we're doing in that house, right? We're connecting with people. And ministry happens, right? It gets personal. It gets real. At men's breakfasts that happen once a month on Saturday, Voltron's forming to a degree. And it happens at Golden Corral, so we also pray for healing after we eat. But you see, when you decide to get together with a handful of people in your area for maybe a time of prayer or Bible study or something like that, not even an official church thing, what's happening is Voltron is forming. And so I want to talk about some problems, some things that prevent us from being the body, that keep us as lions and not as Voltron. And so here's the problem. There's a difference between unity and proximity. So there was this one episode of Voltron where this enemy, the enemy Space Force, they came up with a computer virus. And they somehow implanted that computer virus in the lions. And what it did is it made the lions unable to form Voltron. Alex is shaking his head. He remembers. It's like, I just watched that yesterday. It was my morning devotions. And so anyway, what would happen is they would do their thing. They'd try to form, and it was almost like there was electromagnets repelling them apart. They'd get together, and then the head would pop off. The arm would swing. Or, like, they just could not form. They could all be in the same place. They could all be close to each other, but they couldn't lock together and form Voltron. And here's the thing. It's really possible for us to be in the same room as people, but not be together. How many of you guys have ever been in the same room with someone, but you were clearly not together with them? You know what I call that? Awkward, right? It's like, how many of you guys that's ever been like your marriage for a season? You're like, man, we were in the same room, but we were not together, right? And the only time we got close to each other was to like injure each other. And so anyway, you might be in the same room, but you might not be together. Maybe there's a sibling that you're in the same room, but you're not together. Yeah, maybe there's even just a friend, a person that you know, and you guys can be in the proximity to each other, but you're definitely not in unity. And the unfortunate truth is that life really is full of places that have proximity, but not necessarily unity. Like you might go to work every day and you might be in the same room with people, but you're not, you don't want to be there. Like you're only there because you're paid to be there. And so those places are all over the place, but the church should never be one of those places. The church should never be one of those places where we're in the same room, where we're in proximity, but not necessarily in unity. And that's why in the book of Philippians, the Apostle Paul, the guy who started the church in Philippi. So if you think, well, who is he to tell him what to do? Well, he started the church. So the Apostle Paul started, they think somewhere around 27 churches. And this was one of the churches he started. And so he sends them this letter to basically kind of tell them what to do, how to really be a church. And so Philippians chapter 2 verses, we're going to start with 3 and 4. This is him giving them instructions on how to have unity and not just proximity. Here's how to actually be the body and not just a bunch of people sitting together in the same place. He says, do nothing out of selfish ambition or vain conceit. Rather, in humility, value others above yourselves. There's another translation that says, consider others as better than yourself. So value others, esteem others, treat others better than you're treating yourself. Not looking to your own interests, but each of you to the interests of others. What a huge thing. What a huge instruction, right? How on earth do we begin to tackle this? Don't look to your own interests, but look to the interests of others. And so the scripture here warns us about two personal vices, and we're going to get personal this morning, but I want to start this by saying that this gets a whole lot easier when you recognize this is all of us. There's a reason it's in the Bible, because everybody does it, okay? So these two personal vices, before we even start, I don't want you to stop and ask, do I do this? Let me just tell you now, you do. This is you. This is me. This is all of us. And so he's instructing us how to tamp this down so that we can have real unity with people around us. The reason you have all these environments out there that have proximity but not unity is because people have these two things and they're running rampant. They're not tamped down. So this is all of us. Selfish ambition and vain conceit. He warns us that these two personal vices will short circuit unity in the church. So if you have selfish ambition and vain conceit going unchecked, then what it will result in is large groups of people who are together but not in unity. And so these two vices, to stick with our metaphor, work like the computer virus in Voltron. They will short out our ability to unify. They will keep us functioning as individual lions. And we might fool ourselves into thinking that something good is still really happening because we're a lot of individual lions all functioning in the same place. We go, oh, look, that person has a great ministry. That person's a great Christian. That person's being really kind. That person's talking to guests. That person's involving newer people. That person's, right? And so there's maybe individual lions doing good things here and there, but there's not this unified approach where we're all doing what we should be doing. We're all connected together in thought and in mind. And so this is kind of telling us how to get to that spot. So the first one of these two vices is selfish ambition. And the way that the term is used there in the original language, it was actually kind of a metaphor, and it was referring to a slimy politician, kind of that whole persona, right? How many of you guys have ever seen, maybe I'll explain it because you've probably never seen a slimy politician before. But it's this whole persona of the slimy politician, this person who says really great stuff, they do really great things, they talk to people, they do all this stuff, but all of it is done because they want something. Right? And so I mean, you see it all the time. You see, how many guys have seen politicians kiss babies? Right? They probably don't love those babies. You've seen them go and tour natural disasters and flood zones and all that stuff. This is broad brush. I'm sure some of them are very good people and concerned. But a lot, I mean, they're not there to actually clean up a flood, are they? They're there to be seen as a person who cares about that stuff. And so that's this kind of broad brush idea is that you have this persona. The scripture is using this persona of a slimy politician who says things and does things and goes places and talks to people and interacts with groups, and all of it is done. It's all done as something that's good, but it's done for a self-serving motive. And the truth is that this is so widespread in life that we just have come to accept it. Like, we don't point it out when we see it in politics. We don't usually point it out when we see it in other people. We just assume that everyone's always got an ulterior motive, don't we? Like, we just assume all the time. Like, anytime you hear the government or even in churches, they'll announce something and they'll go, oh, here's what's happened, and they give a reason. And we just assume, well, that's a reason. It's probably not the reason. That's not what's going on. There's always something happening beneath the surface. There's some motive beneath the surface that no one's disclosing. And so now that we get the metaphor, let's talk about how it plays out here. Selfish ambition can play out in the church in a lot of ways. Like, we can join ministry teams. Like, maybe we can join the worship team, not because we want to serve everybody and help them worship, but because we want to be seen by people. Because we've got an ability and we think it's going to get us some recognition and we enjoy the spotlight. There's pastors who get into ministry, not because they want to help individuals and serve individuals, but because they enjoy the spotlight and they enjoy being the person, right? So there's all kinds of ways, you know, we can do things, not because like nice things for people, not because they're nice, not because we want to do them, but we can do them to be noticed, right? Well, how many of you guys have ever like said something nice to someone and then maybe after you said it, you realized you didn't even really say it because you wanted them to hear it. You wanted to be heard saying it. It's like, I'm not sure that my motive in that was even all that great. Or maybe you've said something to someone, not because you want them to feel good, but because you know that if you compliment them, they're going to compliment you, right? There's all these things that we do that appear nice on the surface, but then when we dig a little bit deeper, our motives aren't that great. You know, like we have a board of elders, we call them trustees here, people who are kind of the governing body of the church, and they handle all the affairs of the church. And there's a lot of times in churches where people aspire to positions, not because they want to serve their fellow believers, but because they see it as power. They see it as an opportunity to be on the inside circle, to know what other people don't know, to kind of have a say, to have your opinion matter, right? There's times where people will make donations to churches and they want their name on something. Basically, it comes down to the fact that they're not really giving that because they want to give it. They're giving it because they want to be known as a person that does that kind of thing. And so it all comes down to this question of not what am I doing, but why am I doing what I'm doing? Why am I saying what I'm saying? Why am I participating in the thing I'm doing? Am I doing this for a genuine motive? Or am I doing it because I want to be seen? I want to be noticed. I want to be appreciated. I want people to recognize me as someone that would do that kind of thing. And sometimes, for some of us, power and influence really are the main motive. But the Bible's correction here is broader than just power and influence. It really comes all the way down to the question of the motive itself. Is it selfish in general? Because it's possible for it to be self-serving and not be about power or influence, but still be about me. And so selfish ambition as a category just comes down to doing anything that appears to be for others or for good, but in reality is being done to benefit me, right? And so there's a lot of questions we got to ask ourselves after the fact. And this is one of those things that you kind of only start correcting after the fact until you get some momentum going and you start seeing things. How many of you guys have ever like said something and then after the fact you recognize I said that for a very selfish reason? Now, how many of you guys have caught yourself in that enough that maybe now you get ready to say something and then you hear the question before you say it? Why do I want to tell this story? Why do I want to say this? And then you still say it, but then you feel bad later. But anyway, and so in the Bible, there's a powerful example of this, and it really kind of goes to the heart of how serious this is. So in the book of Acts, you can go back and read it later, there's this couple, their name is Ananias and Sapphira, all right? And so what was happening is there was this huge famine that was decimating the church in Jerusalem. People were starving. It was horrible. But there were some people who had means, some people who owned a lot of property. Some people were business people. They had stuff. And so as people were beginning to starve, people were beginning to suffer, what happened is some in the church were going, you know what? I've got more than I need. And they were selling property. They were, hey, I've got this farm over here that I, you know, while it's a great investment, I don't really need it to survive. And this is about survival. And so these people were actually going and selling their property. Right. So imagine you own, you know, your family owns 50 acres somewhere and you're going to go sell it for $100,000. And these people would bring it to the church, to the pastor. And they'd say, listen, I don't know who's all hungry in this place, but you probably have a better idea. So I just sold my property. Here's the money. I want you to use it to make sure nobody goes hungry. And so that's what was happening in the Jerusalem church. is that as need would continue to pop up, people would just go and sell their stuff, and they'd bring the amount and give it to the church to care for the people. And as this was going on, this couple, Ananias and Sapphira, began to notice, you know what? Those people that do that, people are beginning to take notice of them. They're kind of recognized. One of them was even made a deacon. One of them that did that is now traveling and preaching, and they saw it as an opportunity to elevate their status in the church. But the problem came in that they weren't that generous. Like, I really want to be thought of as being that generous, but I'm not. So they cooked up this plan that they would go and sell their property, and they would bring the money to the church and pretend to be doing what everyone else was doing, giving the whole amount. And they do that, and as they bring the money and they're kind of keeping this guise going, Peter, who's the head of the church at this point, even tries to correct them. And he says, hey, listen, just so that you know, that land is yours. There is nobody expecting you to sell your land. There's nobody, even once you sell it, that money is yours. You don't owe us anything. Now, what do you got here? And even after his attempt to kind of clear the air like that, they bring him. They go, well, we saw everybody struggling. You know us, we can't let anybody go without. So what we've done is we've sold our property, and here's the whole amount. But what they did is they actually divided it up, and they kept this huge chunk of the money for themselves, and they brought this other chunk, and they were going to pretend it was the whole amount. Again, it was their money. Nobody asked them to sell it. Nobody asked them to give the money once the property was sold. But they do that, and so Peter looks at it, and he knows what's happened. Somehow God, through the Holy Spirit, gave him insight into what was happening. And he stops them, and he says, listen, the land was yours. The money was yours. Why did you do such a thing? It's to try to misrepresent what you're doing. And as soon as he said that, the two dropped dead on the spot, judged by God for their sin. And I struggled over that story for years. Like, God, that's an awfully harsh punishment for lying. But the truth is that God's judgment on those two had nothing to do with lying. Because people have lied thousands of times since then and not dropped dead. What that was about was their evil motive. They had this rare moment in the church where it was doing something so beautiful for people. The church was being the church. The church was in unity as the body, so much so that people didn't even consider their own stuff their own anymore. And so there was this rare moment of unity in the church that went all the way down through property lines, and it didn't divide. And what they were doing was jeopardizing that. Their good motives for gross reasons were jeopardizing the unity of the church. And so God judged it very harshly. And here's the thing. We still struggle today with a sinful tendency to do good things for gross reasons. And I want to be clear, we said this already, but to differing degrees, we all deal with this. This is not just certain people. This is not just other people or bad people. This is all of us. That's why it's in the Bible. It's a widespread problem. And here's the thing, we know it in other people because people can feel our gross motives, right? And not always right away. Sometimes it takes a little time and it's usually not super clear, but there's just certain people that you kind of feel gross around, right? You know what I'm saying? Like they kind of come over and they shake your hand, they're talking to you and they're like, and you're just like, I don't know what's up with this person. And you can't point to it exactly. You can't, you know, and there's just people, their motives are just a little bit off, a little bit in question. And you just kind of always feel like this person's doing nice stuff, but I kind of feel like there's an agenda. And so God takes this so seriously because this tendency damages the connectivity of the church. So this creates this phenomenon where now we can have proximity but not unity, where we're close together physically, but then we're all contending for ourselves because we can't trust the motives of people around us. So even though people around us are doing nice enough things, we just don't ever quite feel like we can let our guard all the way down, or at least not with everyone. We kind of have those select few that we're all the way ourselves with, and then everyone else, we have this little bit of a guard. And then when you reproduce that feeling on a wide scale throughout the church, just think about the damage that that can have on our ability to have unity. Because what it turns into is ultimately everyone goes right back to looking out for number one. And that's not what he said in the scripture. He said, in humility, consider others better than yourselves. And that all comes back to our motives. And so I want to be really clear about this, guys. Scripture says this in Romans 8:1. It says, there is now no condemnation for those who are in Christ. So if you're a follower of Jesus, your sin's already been judged in Jesus. God's not looking at you going, dude, you got some stinky, stinky motives. Get away from, right? Like this is a reality, but God's already forgiven you. So there's no condemnation. So I don't want you to feel this morning and be like, oh, I'm terrible. I don't want you to walk out of this morning and be like, dude, I'm just the worst. There's like that. That's not the message. Sometimes when you find out you really stink, it's awfully freeing, isn't it? Because you know what else you find out at the same moment? Everyone else really stinks too. All of us. This is every single one of us. There's so many times I catch myself. Like, why am I telling that story? It's not helping them. I'll listen to someone tell a story they're really excited about, and then it'll remind me of a story I have that's cooler. I'm like, oh yeah, check this out. And then I walk away, and I'm like, I bet they really enjoyed that. No, they didn't. They were enjoying themselves. They were having fun, and here I am like, here, though, you get a little too much spotlight. Let me steal it back over here, right? And so there's all, we all do this. We all have stinking motives. And so hear that. There's no condemnation. Just let it out there. Let it be freeing. Like, you know what? That's me. That's me. And the sooner I own that, the sooner we can begin to tamp that down and begin to enjoy the body of Christ together. So the first step is a repentant heart where we go, you know what, God? I don't know how to fix this, but I'm open to whatever you got for me. I'm open to however you can help me grow and move forward. And a heart that's honest about its own grossness is the way forward. You just got to begin to own it. You got to begin to own it with yourself. And then sometimes if you own it with other people, that'll really check you, right? If you ever have to just tell somebody, you know what, hey, I'm really sorry I did that. That was all about me right there. That wasn't about you at all. You don't have to say that very many times before you start realizing it before you do it. And you go, oh, I don't want to have that conversation again. And so you begin to check yourself, right? Now, moving on from selfish ambition, it says, do nothing out of selfish ambition or vain conceit. And vain conceit is an interesting kind of concept here, and really a really accurate translation of that from the original language to English would be like a permanently hungry self-esteem. So he's saying, do nothing out of empty conceit. It's really like, it's saying there's an empty, hollow spot here where your self-esteem should be. Don't be motivated by a permanently hungry self-esteem. So vain conceit is when we do things and say things, not to gain something. It's not really a selfish motive in that sense, but it's really, everything we do is really about how we feel about ourselves. So it's not so much that you're telling stories to impress other people. You're telling stories to feel good about yourself. It's not so much that you're doing good things to get attention, to get recognition from others. You're doing it trying to convince yourself that you're worth something. See, when our sense of identity is based on the wrong things, it will cause us to function as constant affirmation seekers. See, when it's built on the wrong stuff, when that stuff is no longer enough for you, you're going to become constantly hungry. So there's a lot of people that their self-esteem, their self-image is based on how they look. Well, guess what? That thing's a ticking time bomb. You can hold it together for a while. You can even go and get some surgeries and kind of zoom it back around. You can do, but there is coming a time when that thing is not going to look like it's supposed to look anymore, right? And then you got to be funny like me. And so anyway, that's what happens, you know? And so what happens is then is that maybe it's on your success, maybe my job performance, and then there's going to come a day where you're not going to be the best anymore at your job. And then who are you? And then there's all these things. There's all these different things that we base this self-esteem on. It's based in the wrong stuff. And so then as that thing begins to get challenged, it makes us permanently hungry trying to reaffirm ourselves. And so this is not so much selfish and gross like the other motive was. This is more brokenness, where you have this sucking void in your heart and no amount of affirmation is ever going to be enough to fill it. And I want to be really clear, guys. This will make you frustrating and exhausting for people around you. And it's ultimately going to make you frustrated with yourself, too, because you'll eventually see that pattern. You'll be like, what is wrong with me? And so this issue is actually intensified because what happens is this sucking void causes us to seek human affirmation, and we get a little bit of affirmation, and it actually does make us feel better for a minute. And so we fill this with the wrong thing, and we create an appetite for human affirmation when ultimately you weren't built to be satisfied by human affirmation. And so this thing is that your heart was actually built to crave the approval of God Himself. And now we start replacing it with the substitute. And so the people around us say, oh, that is awesome. That's great. It's like, oh, yeah, that is great. And so then we do some more of that stuff to try to get some more of that great out of people. And it's kind of like being really, really thirsty. Has anyone ever run a really long distance or done something out in the sun and been very exhausted, right? And what's happened in that moment, you're extremely thirsty. And so your throat's dry, you're hot, and you could stop right then and you could chug an ice cold soda. And it would taste awesome. And it would feel great going down, right? That cold soda tickling your throat, man, to get everything off. But you know what you've ultimately done? You further dehydrated yourself, right? Yeah, the syrup in it, the sodium in it, the sugar in it, it's going to taste great. It's going to feel great. But it's actually further exacerbated your condition. And that's what's happening when we use human affirmation to seek what our heart really craves from our Father in heaven. And so that's what I mean, is that you'll get a little bit of affirmation and it'll make you want more and more. And the more people praise you, the more you'll want it. And it'll never, ever be enough. And I want to say this again. We said it about selfish ambition. There is no shame. There's no condemnation for us where we're in Christ, right? But we have to be able to face that this is what we're doing and say, listen, that's me. I am sucking down soda when what I need is water, right? And so what we have to learn to do is redirect our desire for human affirmation, right? And so you know, you learn this with any appetite. If you build an appetite for unhealthy stuff, what you have to do is slowly correct that with an appetite for the right stuff. And so you go, oh, I'm so hungry. I need a Snickers bar. And eventually that catches up with you. And so then you go, you know what? I'm hungry. I need a carrot stick. And you're not going to really want a carrot stick for a while, right? But eventually you eat enough carrot sticks when you're hungry. When you get hungry, you're going to think of a what? A carrot stick, right? And so it's the same thing where it's like you're going to feel like I'm so hungry for human affirmation, and you got to stop yourself and go, no, I don't need human affirmation. I need to spend some time with my Father. I need to be reminded of what He sees when He sees me, right? And so if I want to tell you what He sees. If you're a follower of Jesus, here's what you need to know about you. If you're a follower of Jesus, that means that you are so valuable that God Himself came in human flesh to reclaim you as His own. The God of the universe put on human flesh so He could reclaim you as his own. He saw your individual life eons ago, before you were ever even born, and he chose you. He went to work arranging the events and the people of your someday life so that it would lead you to this moment when you would have a saving knowledge of him, to invite you into his family, into his church at this point in history and in your life. And he did all of this because you are that valuable to him and to what he's going to do in this age, in the world, through his church. So what we have to do is ask the Holy Spirit to help us to see that when we're looking for affirmation from other people, to get that need really met, because human affirmation will never be enough for you. Your need of it will always end up being too much for the community around you. Turn to the real source. And so all of this today really comes down to a very simple but tough question that, as a church, if we ask ourselves regularly, it's going to make the body so much healthier. And the question is this: why am I doing or saying this, really? It's just that simple. Why am I doing this? Why am I saying this? What's really the motive in this conversation? What's the motive in telling this person this? Is it because they really need to hear this? Or is it because I want them to hear me saying this? What's the motive? You see, when we allow God to begin to set us free from selfish ambition and empty conceit, what will happen is people's walls will go down and the church will grow in unity. And that's what's really being described here, is humility. See, when he says, like, do nothing out of selfish ambition or vain conceit, consider others greater than yourself, what's being described is ultimately humility. It's us putting others first in reality, and humility breeds unity. And so this is the good news. This kind of humility was modeled by Jesus, and it will be richly rewarded by God the Father. So we're going to finish Paul's instruction there. It started with do nothing out of selfish ambition or vain conceit. He goes on in verse 5 to say this: in your relationships with one another, have the same mindset as Christ Jesus, who, being in the very nature of God, did not consider equality with God something to be used to his own advantage. Rather, he made himself nothing, taking the very nature of a servant, being made in human likeness, and being found in the appearance of a man, he humbled himself and became obedient to death, even death on a cross. Therefore, God exalted him to the highest place and gave him a name that's above every other name, that every knee should bow in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue acknowledge that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. So he says, take Jesus himself as your example, right? Jesus was God, but he made himself low so that he could lift us up. He laid aside his rights and his importance. He laid aside his power and his preference. He laid aside his fame, his comforts, and ultimately even immortality. He laid it aside for a time. And he didn't just become a person, but he became a person without social clout, like a servant. Jesus made you the point of everything he did, right? That's what he's saying. Jesus put all of his effort into what's good for us at the expense of what was good for him. And that's what he's calling us to, again, with this qualification within the church. You can't do this for just everybody you meet in the world, all right? That would cause you to get dead real fast, okay? So, within the church, though, we do what's good for each other at the expense of ourselves. If it makes you uncomfortable, if it makes you have to give up something, right? We do what's good for each other at the expense of ourselves. That's what we owe each other within the church, because that's what Jesus did for us. He made us the point of everything he did. And here was the promise. He said, listen, think about what Jesus did. He made himself low. And think about today. God has exalted Jesus to the point that you cannot go anywhere in the world and people don't know his name, right? Time itself is marked by him, right? We're in the year 2020 AD, Anno Domini, year of our Lord, right? Time itself is marked by him. Over 2 billion people, I think, worldwide now call him Lord. And even world religions that don't claim he's God still talk about him and explain who they think he is. He's the centerpiece of all of humanity and all human history, right? And he got that not because he achieved it for himself. He humbled himself and God exalted him. The Father exalted him. And so what it's laying out for us is the promise. If you'll humble yourself, God will exalt you. You don't have to worry about your comfort level. You don't have to worry about what you need or what you want. If you put others first, if you do what's good for others at the expense of yourself, God will bless you. God will exalt you. So you have to ask the question, am I going to be more successful at exalting and blessing myself, or is God going to be more successful at that? Who do I think can bless me more? Who do I think can exalt me more? Because if I do it for myself, I'm only going to get what I can get. You see, if you try to take care of you, then you will only get what you can get you. I'll say that again. If you try to take care of you, you will only get what you can get you. But if you put others first, then you will get what God can get you. And that's the promise for the humble. So as we close, I just want to ask you, I just wonder, how often does God have exaltation and blessing just stored up waiting for you, waiting for us, but he can't give it because we're exalting and blessing ourselves? How much is sitting right next to you that you don't see, that he's just waiting if you just stop taking care of you and start taking care of others? I've got all this right here that I want to drop in your life. Let's pray. Father, help us. Help us to take our cues from your son, Jesus. God, help us to embrace not just the forgiveness, but new life in him. And God, I pray that you'd help us as we get free of these things in our lives, like selfish ambition and vain conceit, that as we begin to really learn to be a humble servant, as we serve each other, not ourselves, that a few things will happen. One is that you'll actually honor us. You'll actually exalt us. You'll bless us. But on top of that, we'll unlock the key. We'll open the door for the church to really be the church, for the manifold power and wisdom of God to be poured out through us to those around us. God, help us have a vision for that. Help us to have a vision for the day when as much or more ministry and value and encouragement is happening from side to side all through the church as is ever happening from front to back. That people would go home not just talking about the words they heard from a stage, but talking about the encouragement and the blessing they received from all those around them in the church. Make it so. In Jesus' name, amen. Guys, God bless you. Have a great week. We'll see you next time. Whip, whip, run me like a racehorse.